The Bell P-59 Airacomet stands as a pivotal landmark in the annals of American aviation history. Developed as a top-secret project in the early 1940s as World War II sparked a frantic technology race between the major world powers. The Bell P-59 Airacomet was the United States' first-ever jet fighter, heralding a new era of aerial combat and aeronautical innovation. While it carried over many features from the propeller-driven warbirds that came before it, it also boasted several bold design choices, including its mid-wing configuration, tricycle landing gear, all-metal construction, and the positioning of its twin jet engines in its fuselage, firmly staking its place as a forward-thinking fighter. The P-59 program was crucial in providing invaluable insights into jet propulsion, aerodynamics, and the challenges of high-speed flight, paving the way for subsequent generations of jet-powered aircraft that would dominate the skies in the post-war period. The Bell P-59 Airacomet emerged during a time when jet technology was rapidly evolving across the globe. While the idea of the jet engine had generally been met with skepticism in the U.S., British and German engineers had been gradually advancing with early forms of turbojet technology throughout the 1930s. The race to record the first-ever jet-powered flight was won by the Germans with the Heinkel HE-178 in August 1939, just days before the outbreak of the Second World War. Meanwhile, their British rivals continued making progress. In April 1941, U.S. Army General Harold Hap Arnold observed this firsthand during his visit to England, where he witnessed a taxiing demonstration of the Gloster E 28/39. The following month, this aircraft would make history as the first British turbojet-engined plane to take flight. Convinced of the potential for the United States, he asked the British to provide him with certain resources that would allow him to set the American jet program in motion. These included the plans for the E-28/39's Powerjet's W-1 power plant, a sample of its Whittle W-1X turbojet engine, blueprints for the more advanced W-2B/23 engine, and a small team of engineers. His request was granted. Back in the States, Arnold set about assembling the team that would take on the highly classified mission of building the first American jet aircraft. That September, he contracted General Electric to design their own version of the Whittle engine and Bell Aircraft Corporation to construct a fighter plane that would use it. Shrouded in secrecy, the project was named P-59A, suggesting a non-existent connection with the canceled Bell XP-59 fighter in an effort to confuse any espionage attempts. At General Electric's headquarters in Lynn, Massachusetts, the Whittle engine was labeled as spare part, and any related work was simply categorized as miscellaneous to throw off any prying eyes. It is said that not even the Air Force plant president knew of the existence of P-59A while it was under development. The final design was locked in on January 9, 1942, marking the start of the ambitious construction phase. This began with the initial prototype model known as the XP-59A, of which three were built. General Electric's modified Whittle W-1 engine, named the IA, was a centrifugal flow turbojet that included a single-stage centrifugal compressor, one combustion chamber, and a single-stage turbine. The development of the General Electric IA turbojet engine involved overcoming significant challenges related to high-temperature materials and cooling techniques, as well as ensuring reliability and performance. Engineers focused on creating advanced nickel-based superalloys that could withstand the extreme temperatures generated during jet propulsion, and they applied coatings and treatments to enhance thermal resistance. These innovations in metallurgy were critical for the engine's critical components, such as turbine blades and combustion chambers. Effective cooling was another major hurdle. General Electric engineers utilized air cooling by designing sophisticated airflow management systems to direct cooler air to essential components. They also selected materials with good thermal conductivity and employed heat exchangers to manage the temperature of engine fluids. ensuring that the engine could maintain safe operating temperatures and remain reliable under high-stress conditions. The simplicity of the IA engine centrifugal flow design facilitated rapid development and testing. This straightforward design required fewer stages than axial flow engines, reducing complexity and enhancing reliability. The robust construction made the engine less susceptible to damage, allowing engineers to quickly build and test prototypes. Frequent bench testing and flight trials with the XP-59A, also known as Aerocomet, provided valuable feedback, enabling rapid adjustments and refinements. These efforts ensured the IA engine's viability and laid the groundwork for future advancements in jet engine technology. The first bench test of the IA engine occurred in April 1942. The tests showed promising results, demonstrating that the engine could produce the necessary thrust for jet propulsion. The P-59 stood 12 feet 4 inches tall and measured approximately 38 feet 2 inches in length. In order to provide enough lift for its heavy jet engines, it had relatively large wings. With a wingspan of 45 feet 6 inches and a total wing area of 386 square feet, it had an empty weight of around 7,940 pounds, a loaded weight of approximately 12,700 pounds, and a maximum takeoff weight of about 13,500 pounds. It featured an oval-shaped cross-section and a robust all-metal stressed skin semi-monocoque fuselage designed to maximize strength and durability while minimizing weight. This advanced construction method housed a single, pressurized cockpit, providing the pilot with essential protection and comfort at high altitudes. Though all the P-59 still featured straight wings like its propeller-driven predecessors rather than the swept configurations that would dominate jet fighter design in the years that followed, interestingly, these wings were mid-mounted, featuring two primary spars and an additional false spar in the inner panel. This was crucial for maintaining structural integrity and evenly distributing aerodynamic loads, ensuring flight stability and control. Moreover, the electrically powered tricycle landing gear mounted to the center spar allowed for safer and more efficient ground operations, a forward-thinking choice that set a new standard for future aircraft designs. Beneath the wing roots, the pair of General Electric IA turbojet engines were nestled in streamlined nacelles, optimizing aerodynamics and reducing drag. The P-59 also featured sophisticated cooling systems to manage the high temperatures of jet engines. These systems were integral to maintaining engine efficiency and reliability, critical factors for the sustained operation of jet-powered aircraft. The innovative use of air intakes and cooling ducts illustrated the designer's foresight in solving the thermal challenges posed by jet propulsion. Armament was concentrated in the nose of the aircraft, reflecting the strategic importance of concentrated firepower in combat. Initially, two of the three XP-59As and most YP-59As were equipped with a pair of 37mm M10 autocannons. This formidable weaponry was later adapted in production models to include one M10 autocannon and 3.50 caliber AN/M2 Browning heavy machine guns. Balancing heavy-hitting power with rapid-fire capability to address diverse combat scenarios. Fuel capacity was another critical design consideration. The P-59 carried a total of 290 U.S. gallons of fuel in four self-sealing tanks located in the inner wing panels, enhancing its range and combat endurance. Both production models could be outfitted with 165 U.S. gallon drop tanks under the wings for extended missions, significantly boosting fuel capacity and operational range. The P-59B variant was also equipped with an extra 66 U.S. gallon fuel tank in each outer wing panel, further enhancing its mission versatility. The XP-59A had been assembled on the second floor of an abandoned Pierce Aero factory. Its components were too large for any elevator, so a hole had to be made in the brick wall to extract it. On September 12, 1942, it was moved by train to Muroc Army Airfield in California, now known as Edwards Air Force Base, for flight testing. During high-speed taxi tests on October 1st, Bell test pilot Robert Stanley inadvertently took the aircraft airborne, although Colonel Lawrence Craigie conducted the official maiden flight the following day. A dummy propeller was attached while it was on the ground, masking its true identity. In the months that followed, testing of the XP-59 has exposed numerous issues. While the General Electric IA turbojet engines demonstrated that jet propulsion was viable, like all early jet engines, they suffered from poor throttle response and reliability issues. Aerodynamic evaluations revealed significant stability problems, especially at higher speeds, where the aircraft tended to snake, making it a poor platform for gunnery. Structural integrity tests confirmed the robustness of the airframe, though some components required reinforcement. The data and experience gathered from the XP-59A tests were instrumental in informing the design and development of the YP-59A, the pre-production model. The design team addressed the identified issues by refining the airframe for better aerodynamic efficiency and enhancing the engines to improve performance and reliability. However, while the General Electric J-31 engine used in the 13 service test YP-59 was more powerful than the IA, the performance boost turned out to be minimal, increasing the top speed by only 5 miles per hour and shortening the time before an overhaul was needed. Indeed, when the Army Air Force conducted combat trials against the propeller-driven Lockheed P-38J Lightning and Republic P-47D Thunderbolt fighters in February 1944, they found that the older planes actually outperformed the jet. Other problems also persisted. During dive tests in 1944, one YP-59A had to make a belly landing, and another crashed when its entire tail assembly broke off. While the USAAF had placed an initial order for 100 production models, they ultimately concluded that the P-59 was best suited for training pilots to handle jet engine aircraft. However, for this role, it was decided that only 50 aircraft would be necessary, so on October 10th, the order was reduced by half. The USAAF ultimately selected the Lockheed P-80 Shooting Star as its inaugural operational jet fighter. This proved a wise decision, as the P-80's General Electric J-33 engine was more powerful than the J-31, providing better thrust and allowing it to reach up to 600 miles per hour. The Shooting Star offered a greater operational range and more reliable performance than the Aerocomet. Meanwhile, in a fitting acknowledgement of Britain's role in the program's inception, the third YP-59A was handed over to the Royal Air Force and designated RJ-362/G. In return, the U.S. received the first production Gloster Meteor 1, designated EE-210G. However, perhaps unsurprisingly, British pilots reported that they found the aircraft disappointing compared to the jets they were already flying. Additionally, two YP-59A Aerocomets were delivered to the U.S. Navy, where they were evaluated as the YF-2L1. Once again, their impact was underwhelming, and they were quickly deemed unsuitable for carrier operations. Despite this, the Navy received three P-59Bs between 1945 and 1946, retaining their designations and used all five jets for training and flight testing. By 1950, both the USAAF and the Navy had phased out the use of the Bell P-59 as a training aircraft, marking the end of its service career. Most were scrapped, though a handful survived. It is believed that six P-59s remain today. A P-59A is on display at the Marchfield Air Museum in Riverside, California. While P-59Bs can be found at Edwards Air Force Base and the National Museum of the United States Air Force at Wright-Patterson Air Force Base near Dayton, Ohio. While the P-59 wasn't a major success in itself, it represented a massive milestone in the story of aeronautical design in the United States. Providing pilots with valuable experience in operating jet aircraft and paving the way for more advanced models soon to come.